AWS. And it's a pleasure to be here today. So I think that stream processing and event processing is a rather important topic, right? Because in today's application stacks, data is continuously generated in a fairly substantial amount. And I think that we can all agree that all sorts of different companies can substantially benefit from continuously analyzing their data in real time, as opposed to running batch jobs once a day or once a week. However, building a reliable and scalable stream processing pipeline can be a rather challenging task, right? And what I'm going to show you today is the slides are not there. Sorry for that. Nope. Sorry. So, sorry for that. And what I'm going to show you today is how you can build such an infrastructure on top of AWS and with little operational overhead, so that you can actually focus on your business logic and not running and setting up Flink for solving your problem. Okay. However, building a stream processing pipeline in itself is complex, but even the task of event and stream processing is challenging in itself, right? So there are a couple of properties you want to have when you're running stream processing jobs. So you want to have consistency and high availability, even if single nodes of your cluster go down during the processing. You also are looking usually for low latencies and high throughput of your stream processing system. And you don't want to compromise on the expressiveness of the queries. So you're looking for expressive queries that can be evaluated on top of your stream processing engine and flexible time windows that actually allow you to implement the application logic you want to implement. And last but not least, you're really looking for a system that can tolerate out-of-order events in case things get mixed up from the source to the actual event processor. And this is definitely the wrong place to pitch Flink. Right, you all know that Flink meets these requirements quite well. So problem solved, right? So why I am here today, right? So it's actually the point is that building and running a scalable and reliable infrastructure is much more than just running Flink on your laptop, right? And what I'm going to show you in the next couple of minutes, how AWS can help you to build and run such an infrastructure with little operational overhead. And in order to illustrate what it actually means to build such an infrastructure, I'll use an example that is dealing with taxi trips in New York City. So if you attended the training on the first day of the conference, this setting may, you may find the setting rather familiar. So basically, let's just assume for a moment we are operating a taxi company in New York City, right? And we want to optimize our operations by stream processing and deriving real-time insights so that we can react to recent events. So we want, for instance, to identify hotspots, so that are points where many taxi rides are requested. Or we want to be able to tell how long it would take a taxi to get to a certain point. Right? So this is the entire setting in which I'm discussing the use case. And in the next couple of slides, I'll show you how you can actually build that on top of AWS. So this is a rather generic and simple pattern for building a stream processing pipeline. So on the left-hand side, you have the data producers, which are the taxi cabs in our case. And on the right-hand side, you do have the consumers that are processing the data in some form. And in between, you have some kind of streaming storage that serves as a buffer. And basically allows you to separate the producers from the consumers. And that makes sense and pays off in several cases. So first of all, in case a consumer goes down, the producers can still ingest data into the streaming pipeline. It's just buffer there, and once the consumer comes up again, it can pick up from where it left off and reprocess the backlog of events. Then you can also build infrastructures or architectures where different applications are reading the same data from a single stream. Right. And last but not least, you can scale those two components independently. Right. If you see a traffic spike on one end, you can just scale your streaming storage and wait and leave the event processor as it is, if that's what you want to do. Right. So in order to implement the use case I've been talking about previously, we basically need something, some kind of streaming storage. We need something to run Flink on. And we want to visualize our data. So we need a component there as well. So I'll start with the data ingestion piece. Right? So for data ingestion, we're going to use a service called Kinesis Streams, which to capture and store the data, the incoming data from the taxi rides. So a Kinesis stream is basically a replayable ordered log of events that is durably stored across multiple availability zones and gives you a data retention of 1 day up to 7 days. And a Kinesis stream basically consists of shards, and each shard can take supports 1 megabyte per second of ingress and 2 megabytes of seconds of egress. And by adding and removing shards to your stream, you're basically scaling the throughput of your stream. Okay. To actually run Flink, we are going to use Amazon Elastic MapReduce. EMR basically gives you access to a managed Hadoop cluster. So it basically allows you, it will provision a cluster for you, configure the entire cluster according to the applications you want to be on there. It will then monitor the condition of the cluster, replace failed nodes. It will also allow you to scale the cluster seamlessly in both directions. And it's tightly integrated with other AWS services, such as storage, networking, security, and things like that. So you can basically use EMR to quickly spin up a Hadoop cluster, which gives you access to a YARN environment where you can just deploy Flink on. And last but not least, we are going to use Amazon Elasticsearch service and Kibana for the visualization of the data. So the Flink job is actually going to push the results to Amazon Elasticsearch, and we'll use that for visualizations. So Amazon Elasticsearch basically provides you a managed Elasticsearch cluster, so you don't need to take care of setting up the cluster, maintaining the instances that are powering the cluster. It allows you to make snapshots to S3 and all these kinds of stuff. So it takes away a lot of the friction that is involved with setting up an Elasticsearch cluster for you. So this is basically the overall architecture we'll end up when we're implementing the use case. We'll start off with an EC2 instance that generates and ingests individual taxi trips to a Kinesis stream. So basically, I've taken a data set that is available with a record of taxi trips in New York City. And this EC2 instance is basically replaying this data set into a Kinesis stream. From there, Flink will pick up the records, do the processing we want to do, and then push the data to Elasticsearch. So that's enough of talking. Let's go ahead and actually build the architecture I've been describing. So what does it take to come up with something like that? So I'm already logged on to the AWS management console. I'll just make things a little bit larger. I guess that's OK to read. So I'll start off with creating a Kinesis stream. So I'll head to the console of the Kinesis service. Kinesis is actually comprised of several different services, Kinesis Streams, Kinesis Firehose, and Kinesis Analytics. And for this particular use case, I'll just leverage Kinesis Streams. So I'll go to the console and create a Kinesis stream, which basically just requires me to enter a name. So let's choose taxi trips. And now I need to tell the service how many shards should be provisioned for this stream. And it actually helps me to come up with a sensible number. So first of all, it wants to know how large the records are. And in this particular case, I'm just ingesting taxi trips, which are JSON blobs that are rather small. So 1 kilobyte will be enough. And then how many records am I expected to ingest into the stream? And for this particular example, I'll just use 30,000 records. So I'll replay the data set in a speed that I'll end up with 30,000 records, and just to be sure, I'll pick like 32,000 to have some buffer in case things are a bit different than expected. And I have a single application that is reading from the stream, namely the Flink application. So the console tells me, well, for this kind of properties, you want to have 32 shards, which seems about right, so I'll just use this value and then create the respective stream. And that's all it takes, right? So now in the background, the service will provision a stream with 32 shards so that we can start ingesting data into the stream. And again, the data is replicated across multiple availability zones. There's no single point of failure when you're using Kinesis. Next, I will provision an EMR cluster, right? So that I have something to run Flink on. And to create a cluster, there are actually two different options. One is the quick options, where you can just pick default settings for more or less everything and hit create cluster on a single page. However, I want to pick the applications that should be installed on this cluster. So I'll go to advanced options configure the cluster more specifically. So here you can see there's a wide set of applications that can actually be bootstrapped on the cluster. So I'll certainly use Flink. I'm not so interested in Pig because we want to do stream processing. I am, though, interested in high availability of my cluster. So I'm relying on Zookeeper, or Flink relies on Zookeeper. So I want to bootstrap that onto my cluster as well. And I'm not interested in you and Hive also. Maybe Ganglia would be nice to monitor the conditions of the cluster. You can then enter various different configuration options that are not that interesting in this setting. So I'll head over to the next page. And here I can determine the size of my cluster. Right? A cluster has always a single master node and then a set of core and task nodes. And for this particular use case, I'll use three instances, three core nodes to power my cluster. So I'll end up with a Hadoop cluster with four instances. And as Flink is compute bound, or my job is compute bound, I'll pick an instance type that is optimized for compute workloads. So instead of a M3 instance, which is a general purpose instance, I'll use a C4 XLarge instance to power my cluster. And as I've said, I want my cluster to be three instances large. Okay. So heading over to the next console, here you can adapt general options such as logging and so, but for this particular use case, it's not that interesting. And last but not least, you get to choose the security options. So here I'll specify an SSH key pair so that I can SSH into the master node and then run jobs on the cluster. And that's basically it. So now I'm creating the cluster. And as you can see in the background, the service now go ahead, spin up instances, configure them appropriately. And once everything is set up, it'll present you the login to the master node. And you can go ahead and use your cluster. And last but not least, I'll create an Elasticsearch cluster. Right? So we want to visualize our data by means of Kibana. So I'll use Amazon Elasticsearch for that. And very similarly, I just hit create cluster and enter some properties such as the name. Taxi trips will do. I pick an Elasticsearch version, so the most recent version that is supported is 5.5. Hit next. Now I get to determine the size of my Elasticsearch cluster. So again, I'm interested in a high availability setup. So I'll choose two nodes of a certain type, namely M3 XLarge. I don't expect too much traffic on my Elasticsearch cluster. And I want to make sure that those instances are placed in different availability zones. So I select Enable Zone Awareness. You can furthermore configure the storage of the cluster, but in this case, it's fine. 10 gigabytes per node is just enough. And next, you need to configure the security access or the permissions who can access your cluster. And this is a bit different than running a vanilla cluster because this is integrated with the IAM service that is in charge of all the security-related topics in AWS. So for now, I'll just use copy and a policy from another cluster. And basically, this policy tells Elasticsearch Service that it should allow certain requests from a certain set of IP addresses. So it's certainly not a best practice to open it up to the entire world, but I guess it's okay for this demo. In addition to whitelisting IP addresses, you can also sign requests so that you can be sure that only people that have credentials can interact with your cluster. I'll hit next, get to review my choices, and hit confirm. And now again, in the background, an Elasticsearch cluster is provisioned for me. As this may take some time, so in particular, Elasticsearch takes some time to come up, I've already prepared an environment that is up and running by means of a CloudFormation script. But there's nothing special with this environment, right? It is as if I would have created those resources manually. So I'll, in the next couple of steps, I'll use resources from this environment to show you how things go on. Okay, so now we have the independent components running, and I can start submitting jobs, a Flink job to my cluster. So what I'm going to do is I will SSH. I will SSH into the master node of the EMR cluster to start a Flink job, right? So I configure the security, or the security groups allow access for SSH only, and I'm using that to access the master node. I'll then submit or start a Flink session. So basically, that is a wrapper command that sets the environment variables correctly so that Flink comes up appropriately. As you can see, now Flink is this Flink stop is starting. There's some zookeeper magic going on. And now Flink is up and running. And again, I didn't like install Flink manually or anything. It just comes with your cluster if you select that in the management console. Okay. So now I want to access the Flink UI, right? So how would I do that? It's not really clear how you can access something that is running on the master node. So how am I doing this? If you were watching closely, you may have noticed that I'm using a very specific property for SSH here. So what that property does is basically it opens a local SOX proxy on my laptop, and I can then tunnel requests to the Flink UI through this proxy to the master node. So in this case, I don't need to open ports on the master node. I just use the SSH connection and tunnel requests through this SSH connection to Flink, or to the Flink UI. So I'll reconnect, and I can then head to the EMR management console, pick the right cluster. So this is the one that has been pre-provisioned, and it immediately tells me, okay, if you want to go to the resource manager, here's a link that you can click. And now this URL is pointed to the local SOX proxy. And from there, it goes to the YARN resource manager. And here we can see we have a cluster running. Actually, it has three different nodes, which seems about right. Some containers are running on these nodes. So apparently, Flink is up and running. But more importantly, I can just hit on the applications view. I can just hit application master, and that actually takes me to the Flink UI. So as expected, Flink is running. And we can now go ahead and submit a job to Flink. So I'll just quickly download the jar file I've prepared to the master node of my cluster, and then I'll start the Flink job on EMA. Right? So it's as easy as that. Now the Flink job is submitted to the Flink cluster, and it seems like it works. So if I now go to the Flink UI, I can actually see the job is running on my cluster. Okay, great. So now Flink is up and running. It's already reading from the Kinesis stream. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to start emitting events into the Kinesis stream. So for that, I will SSH into an instance I have prepared. So excuse me, I'll make that a bit bigger. Okay, so now I SSH into an EC2 instance that I have already prepared, and I'll start a Java program that basically reads taxi trips from an object in S3 and ingests individual events into a Kinesis stream. So let me just download that jar file and then execute it with the proper parameters. So that looks all right. And if we now go to the Flink job, we should see that events are already arriving at the cluster, right? So now I'm processing, now Flink is actually reading events that are ingested into Kinesis stream, and the results are pushed to Elasticsearch. So now we can finally go to Kibana that comes included with Amazon Elasticsearch to visualize the results. Right. So I just need to create appropriate index. Once the index is there, that looks all right. I can load the dashboard I've prepared for visualization, so I'm not going to build that manually right now. So okay. And if we navigate to the dashboard, we should see that there is already data there. So as you would expect, in Manhattan, there is more demand for taxi trips than everywhere else. You can see some spikes at the airport. So in JFK and LaGuardia, you have a cluster of taxis, but that is somehow expected. And to show you that data is really flowing into the system, I'll just change the time span a bit. And if I now refresh, you should see that the graphs actually change while new data is added to the Elasticsearch index by the job. Okay, so I guess that's fairly nice. I cheated a little because I've prepared those resources, but it takes about 15 minutes to actually provision them, which is not too bad. There's one other thing I want to show you, namely the CloudWatch console. So CloudWatch is a service that collects metrics of all kinds of different services, and that includes Elasticsearch, Kinesis, and EMR. And I have prepared a dashboard that visualizes important metrics of this particular job. So at the very top, we have graphs that are related to the Kinesis stream. So the blue line indicates how many messages per minute are arriving at the Kinesis stream. So we're currently at 1.9 million records per minute that are arriving at the stream. And more importantly, there is a metric for write provisioned throughput exceeded and for read provisioned throughput exceeded. So as I've already told you, you can ingest a megabyte per second into a Kinesis shard, but you can only ingest 1,000 records per second into a Kinesis shard. So if you are sending more records than what you have provisioned on your stream, those API calls will eventually be throttled, and that is visible through this metric. So if you have ever worked with such kind of system, these errors are your nemesis, right? You want to closely watch the write provision throughput exceeded and reprovision throughput exceeded metric, because it tells you when your system is under-provisioned. And in this case, the metric tells me that roughly 8.5% of requests are throttled, which is a really bad sign, in particular as the application I've written that ingests data into the stream has some back pressure capabilities built in. So this is a really bad sign. Something is going horribly wrong here. And if we were to dig into the details, we would figure out, well, we thought we were ingesting 30,000 events per second into the stream, but actually we are trying to ingest around 60,000 events into the stream. So we have drastically under-provisioned our Kinesis stream. So what now, right? The good news is that you can easily scale your Kinesis stream. So if I just head over to the Kinesis console, go to streams, select the proper stream, I can now go ahead and tweak the properties of the stream. I could, for instance, enable server-side encryption or just scale the stream, and that's exactly what I'm doing now. So I'm roughly sending events at a rate of 60,000 events per second, so I'll just double that number and hit save, and now in the background, Kinesis will add further shards to my stream. Okay, so that was kind of easy to mitigate. Another thing I want to show you is at the very bottom. So here we have metrics that relate to the Elasticsearch index. The blue line indicates how many documents have already been indexed by Elasticsearch. So we are about 70,000 documents that have been sent to Elasticsearch, which seems nice. However, if, let me refresh so that, if we look at the CPU utilization of the Elasticsearch cluster, we are about 17% utilization, which is not really ideal because we're wasting resources of the Elasticsearch cluster. So what I'm going to do now is I'll simply scale down my Elasticsearch cluster. So I'll head over to the console and hit configure cluster, and now I can just pick a smaller instance size. So instead of M3 large, I'll use an M3 medium instance to back my cluster. I still want to be the two nodes, but I want smaller instances. And I guess, and again, I just hit submit, and the service is now internally reconfiguring the cluster so that I end up with smaller machines that are with a higher utilization. Okay, and just for the fun of it, I now want to simulate node failure in my EMR cluster. So what I'm going to do now is I'll head over to the EMR console and just kill one of the instances that is backing my cluster. Right. So I'll navigate to hardware, and I want to kill a core node. Oops. And I want to pick one of those. So now I'm in the EC2 management console, and without telling EMR or anyone else, I'll just kill the instance. So I'll just say, okay, terminate this instance, which immediately shuts it down. So I got a warning. this may not be the best idea, but let's see how that goes. Okay, so now the instance is shutting down and eventually it's terminated. Well, it takes a bit longer than usual, but eventually it's gone. So let's see how Flink reacts. So I have configured Flink so that it checkpoints to S3. And what's going to happen now is eventually Flink will realize, okay, there is a node gone, and it will restart the job on the remaining cluster and will reinitiate this job from the safe point, from the checkpoint that has been stored on S3. So this usually takes a moment, but eventually Flink will figure out that something is going on. So let's just briefly recap what we have done. We have built An RTP architecture consisting of a Kinesis stream, an EMR cluster, and Elasticsearch to power our use case. We then started to scale up the Kinesis stream. We scaled down the Elasticsearch cluster, and we terminated a node of the entire cluster. Right. So quite a couple of things are going on right now. By now, Flink realized, okay, a node failed, and it will go ahead and restart the processing from the last checkpoint. So let's see how it goes. The job is canceled. And hopefully, it'll come up. So if it doesn't work, it's not my fault. It's the fault of Flink. It takes a bit longer than usual. So let's just refresh the page. Okay, one job seems to be stuck. Yep. And therefore it doesn't free. Ah, oh, that's too bad, because now I cannot show you that the entire thing is still running. I'm not sure that hasn't happened before. Of course it hasn't. But I hope that... Anyhow. Okay, so you just need to believe me that if Flink were to come up again, you would see that the entire architecture is still responsive. So you would see in the dashboards that still events are arriving and new documents are added to Elasticsearch, which is quite interesting because so many things are going on. Okay, so just as a desperate act, I'll hit refresh and hope that something changed. No, not really. Okay. Well, anyhow, you got to believe me, and it's not my fault. Okay. So to finish off the talk, I'll discuss a couple of best practices and lessons learned. The first thing you'll notice when you want to build this kind of architecture is that the Flink Kinesis connector is not available from Maven Central, which is basically caused by incompatible licenses of the two projects. So you need to build the connector by yourself. Unfortunately, the latest Maven release has some problems with the way Flink is shading dependencies. So although it is possible to use Maven 3.3 to build the Flink connector, I still would just suggest to use one of the older versions to not run into those problems. So you can either build it yourself, or I've prepared a CloudFormation template that spins up a code build job to build Flink in a serverless fashion, so you can just download those artifacts, and once you have those artifacts, you can reuse them for your deployments. Then once you have the Kinesis connector, there are two important properties you want to tune. The first one is AWS credentials provider, which basically determines how Flink picks up credentials to authenticate against Kinesis. And if you set this to auto, Flink will actually pick up the credentials from the roles that are associated with an EMR cluster, which basically allows you to avoid storing permanent credentials on the Flink cluster or in your source code. Right? The second important option is the shard get records interval millis, which basically determines how often Flink pulls data from a Kinesis stream. So you can ingest data into a single shard with a rate at 1,000 transactions per second, but you can only pull data from a Kinesis shard 5 times a second. So effectively, this means if you spread this evenly across a 1 second interval, you can pull every 200 milliseconds data from a Kinesis stream. So whatever you do, don't set this value below 200. Right? However, there are good reasons to even increase the value to a second, or in the example I was running, I set it to 2 seconds. First of all, in case your Flink job fails, you need to reread records from Kinesis that have already been processed, so you need higher throughput there. So I would suggest to increase that for these kind of use cases. And if you have multiple applications that are concurrently reading from the same stream, it may be a good idea to increase this value as well. Right? However, the downside of this is that it introduces latency into your architecture. Right? Okay. So this slide talks about how you can connect to Kinesis, to the Flink dashboard running on EMR. It's basically telling you what I've showed during the demo. Right? You use dynamic port forwarding to SSH into the master node, then use a browser plugin such as FoxyProxy to redirect these kinds of URLs. So this is not an extensive list. You need to check the documentation for all the details. But basically, the idea is that URLs that are matching this pattern are redirected to localhost, and from there, they are forwarded to the master node. And then you can simply go to the EMR console, click Resource Manager, and from there, navigate to the Flink Application Master. During the demo, I was actually SSHing into the master node and issuing commands manually there. Alternatively, what you can do is you can submit a step to the AWS API, and from there, it will be pushed to your cluster, which is nice because this allows for automation. So you can then use your AWS credentials without logging into the EMR cluster to submit steps or jobs, Flink jobs, to your EMR cluster. This slide again iterates over the importance of monitoring your entire infrastructure. Right? In particular, Kinesis, you want to closely monitor a couple of metrics. I've already mentioned that it's fairly important to closely monitor the write provision throughput exceeded and read provision throughput exceeded. If those metrics go beyond a certain threshold, you certainly want to get notified and dive into the details why you are throttled and if you need to scale. You can even automate this, but the least thing you should be doing is get notified if things go wrong. And a second important metric is the get records iterator age milliseconds, which basically denotes the age of the last record that has been read by all get records call against the stream. So this tells you how much your processing lags behind the events in the stream. And what you can see here in this portion of the graph is the blue line indicates how many records are read from Kinesis, and the orange line indicates the iterator age milliseconds. And what happened here is I actually terminated a node, and Flink had to recover from this failure. So as expected, the blue line suddenly terminates, no events are read from the stream, and this metric, the iterator age milliseconds, goes up because we haven't been reading events from the stream for a moment. One thing that is important to note here is during the time when no one is reading from your stream, this metric isn't updated. So if you're monitoring this metric, you want to set a threshold. So if records get older than a certain amount of time, and if no data is published to this metric, things are going horribly wrong. So just be aware of that. Last but not least, I'll briefly mention how we can realize HA on EMR. So first of all, Flink relies on ZooKeeper. But as I have shown you during the demo, you can easily bootstrap ZooKeeper on your EMR cluster and then use that to realize your HA setup with Flink. One thing you want to be aware of that if you're interested in fast failovers, you want to over-provision your EMR cluster, because if a node dies, it takes some time until the node is reprovisioned, and it takes even longer for Flink to pick up those resources. So if you want to do fast failovers, simply over-provision your cluster. And one thing you may not be aware of, I've mentioned I'm checkpointing data to S3, but I'm actually using externalized checkpoints. What this allows me to do is, if my entire cluster dies, I can restart a fresh job from this externalized checkpoint, which is not possible from a conventional checkpoint. Okay. And if you want to learn more, the AWS blog contains lots of useful information. I've highlighted a post here on running Flink on AWS, and I gave you a link to a GitHub repository that contains the sources on how you can run this demo in your own accounts. So I hope I've proven my point that you can get started quickly with Flink on AWS. We've built an infrastructure that processes taxi stream, taxi trips at a rate of 60,000 events per second. We scaled the entire infrastructure. We killed one of the nodes. Flink sadly didn't recover from that. I've no idea why, but I guess you believe me that during that time, the entire infrastructure was remaining responsive and available. And with that, I'll open it up for questions. Thank you. So there's the microphone.
So how does this all work now if I Dockerize my Flink application? Then mm-hmm. am I then basically out of EMR and go into your container service and then I have to take care of everything? Or how does it work and where are the kind of the benefits, disadvantages compared to using EMR?
Yes, so the benefit of using EMR is that it will very quickly provision your cluster with a YARN environment where you can just deploy your Flink job. The downside of EMR at this point is that an EMR cluster is always running in a single availability zone and the master node is a single point of failure. So if you are very sensitive to latency, in particular in case of failure, have very strict SLAs, it may make more sense to deploy it on a cluster, on a containerized environment, because there you can do much faster failovers, and even in case an entire AZ becomes unavailable, your Flink setup will remain responsive, right?
But then you have to take care of it.
Exactly, but then you have to take care of provisioning the cluster and so on.
So I'm just wondering if assuming that I want to push data to S3 instead of Elasticsearch, won't S3 will be bottleneck from a bandwidth limitation point of view? I mean, what's bandwidth limitation anyway? Because you do using it for checkpoints anyway. So
yes, so it works pretty well for checkpointing, depending on. So if you want to use a bucketing sink to write data to S3, there's currently some problems with the consistency model of S3, so it may not work in all cases. What I would recommend you to do is instead push the data to a Kinesis stream and then use Firehose to persist it into S3, because then you're just dropping the data into a stream, which doesn't have any, which has much nicer properties in the way it can scale, and then you can use Firehose to ingest the data in batches to an S3 destination, right? And eventually, I guess the problem that the bucketing sync currently has will go away, and then you can reconsider your decision and use that to write data to S3.
So during bootstrapping of the EMR, you selected the option of Zookeeper.
Yes.
So does that option make sure the Flink client install is already set up for HA? Or do you have to manually go and set it up?
What I did is the Flink program is configured in a way so that it will connect to Zookeeper. So what I actually did is I changed the configuration, the Flink configuration, and pointed it to the Zookeeper instance or to the IP address of the Zookeeper installation that is there. Right. Okay. Thank you.